Hi, everyone. This is a total treat for me. I'd like to welcome you to one of our In Conversation events. We've had a few of these this year. And today we are lucky to have Mark E.J. Newman. I don't even know what E.J. stands for, other than distinguishing you from the other Mark Newman at Michigan. But for those of you familiar with networks, Mark should be no stranger, of course. I won't rhyme off all the various titles and things, but you can check out either his webpage or his Wikipedia page. What I do want to pay a little bit of attention to, though, is the fact that you're the Anatol Rapoport Distinguished Professor of Physics. And this is, that's in itself a very, from my perspective, a very cool title. Not the least of which, for those of you who know Rapoport's history, in addition to being a very esteemed physicist, done lots of work in math, he ended up in peace and conflict studies at the University of Toronto, which is my alma mater. And so it was nice to see someone that had such a cohesive and broad career there, and to and I think it's a great person to have as a chaired name. So, Mark's career goes back. I think your first paper published was '93, according to the list there. So it goes back a while away. But it really, a lot of work in networks started around the turn of the century, millennia, and so forth. And since then, it's been just a string of home runs in this field, to the point where a lowly sociologist with programming skills such as myself just kept seeing his name pop up again and again. And so now, having made his way back to Oxford, his alma mater, everybody seems to want a piece of him. So instead of asking for yet another talk on the intro to networks, or a really brutal talk on your recent work that you've been doing, we figured to do something slightly different, and this to have it as being no work. Now, this was a great idea when I thought it was no work back in the day, but it did involve a little bit of work from me going back. But it was a treat, actually. It was a treat going back and reading some of these papers and thinking about it and working my way through this stuff. So Mark's agreed to be interviewed by myself, and they wonder at what point I'll be able to fill up some space if we get quiet. And I'm like, I don't know, I'll be fine. Will Mark be able to get a chance to speak is the question. But I guess kind of to start off, I mean, going back to early work, even before sort of some of the more classic stuff, I guess the big paper, that really brought you and Michelle to a lot of people's attention, her paper with you on that early community detection algorithm. And, obviously since then we've had just huge advances in community detection, a lot of stuff here at Oxford. Before then, min, flow, max, or min cut, max flow problems and that sort of thing. But I'm just wondering, what was sort of the tipping point? How did you arrive at a formula based on, edge betweenness?
So, first of all, hello everyone. Thank you, Bernie, for that nice introduction. So Bernie's referring to a paper that I published in 2002 with Michelle Gervin, who incidentally was in Oxford the day before yesterday, and is now a professor of physics at the University of Maryland. We published a paper on community structure in networks. It's a topic that people had thought about previously. There's work in the sociological literature on it, but so it wasn't a new idea, but that paper perhaps brought it to a new audience. So that paper sort of it posed the question, and then it gave a potential solutions question. The question is, if I have a network such as a social network of connections between people, and I believe that it breaks up into groups somehow, there's a clump of friends here and there's a clump of friends there, then can I find those clumps and determine who's in which clump? You might think that would be an easy question. I just look at the network and see where the clumps are. But the catch is that often these networks are very large and very dense. Sure, you can just look at it if it's got 20 nodes in. But if it's got 25 billion nodes in, like the largest snapshots of the World Wide Web, then you cannot do that. You can't make any meaningful picture of it. So you need some automated way of trawling through the data and analyzing it. So we proposed a method of doing it. Now, I'd have to say, looking back, so that paper has been widely cited, but I'd have to say it really gets cited for asking the question, not for giving the answer.
Yeah.
The method that we proposed is not a method that people use anymore because better methods have come along. What it did was get people excited about this question so that they came up with better methods. And now we have, you know, actually really good ways of doing this problem. That method did not give bad answers, but it was slow. So the two things that you need to worry about when you're making up computer algorithms are, one, the quality of the answers they give, and two, how fast do they run. And people often think about the first of those without paying much attention to the second. But within computer science, a large part of what they care about is how fast things will run. There are many, many computer science papers about algorithms whose sole contribution to the field is to give an analysis of how fast something will run. So that's of paramount importance, and it becomes especially important when you're looking at the very large networks that we have today. In historical social network studies, dozens of nodes would be typical, and now millions or billions is quite common. So it was really speed that killed that method. And the method that we proposed was otherwise, I think, a sensible one, which basically looks for the bridges between communities and removes them from the network. If you think there's a clump here and a clump here with only a few connections between them, then let's try and identify those connections between them and remove those. There is a standard method that identifies nodes or edges in networks that lie between others, called betweenness. And so if that's your goal, this is kind of an obvious thing to use. So
one of the things I wanted to ask about that, though, is, you know, obviously, so this is the Gurman-Newman algorithm. It's edge betweenness. So you take a network. I'm assuming most people here would be familiar with some of the basic network stuff. But if not, chime in or just frown, and then we'll see what we can do. So yeah, so you keep deleting edges of the highest betweenness till this network kind of breaks up. Now, this was before, and we'll talk a little modularity later, but it's before modularity, before you had come up with what was asserted to be a reasonable function for determining goodness of fit. And so, looking at the original paper in there, you use dendrograms, and you look at the hierarchical structure of the network. And so, you know, you break into clumps, and then you break into smaller clumps, and smaller, and smaller, and smaller, until you have no clumps left. And it just struck me, we don't really use those dendrograms anymore. Nobody pays that much attention to the notion of a nested community structure.
Mm-hmm.
And so, do you feel that anything's been lost with that? Or why are we just saying, oh, we've got a modularity score or whatever score, some sort of quality function, instead of proposing that communities are composed of smaller communities and smaller and so forth?
So we do kind of do things like that, but a simple hierarchy of that kind doesn't cover all the possibilities.
Mm-hmm.
So these days, people instead consider things where you sort of break it up into groups and then you ask sort of what the probability or frequency of connection is between the groups. And if those probabilities are sort of strictly hierarchical in the sense that you have strong probabilities of connection between groups and then weaker ones between groups of groups and still weaker ones between groups of groups of groups and so forth, then you would have something that could be represented accurately by a dendrogram. However, it's entirely possible that you don't get that.
Yeah.
So we get all sorts of, in fact, get all sorts of mixed structures in a network where you can have stronger and weaker connections between all sorts of different groups. And this means that it's not strictly hierarchical, and a dendrogram is actually not a strong enough representation to capture that kind of thing. So people are still interested in the structure between groups and within groups, but they use different structures to represent it. I'm not saying that dendrograms are a bad idea. I think that they can capture a lot, but they're of interest primarily when you have particular sorts of structure, such as so-called assortative structure, where most of the interest is what's going on within groups, and the between group structure is not so important.
So if I actually will sort of working up to modularity, and then when I read some of the early papers on this, a lot of it actually seemed to have come from assortativity or sort of mixing, which I guess it's obvious now from reading the paper, but it wasn't at the time. So can you tell me a little about why there was a need of yours to look at this, or was like, we have a problem, or did you find a phenomenon where it just seems like a lot of the high degree nodes are linking to high degree nodes? What can we do to formalize that?
So, you know, it was a sequence of developments. If you go back and look at the papers, you realize all the ideas weren't there at the beginning, and it took a while to work things out. So we had worked on community structure and then sort of dropped the problem for a while. And I was working on other things, and I worked on assortative mixing. So assortative mixing is in networks is the phenomenon that nodes or people, for instance, in a social network that are alike in some way tend to be connected. So you could have assortative mixing by where you live or by language. People who talk the same language tend to be friends, and people who talk different languages tend to be different. Or by age. People tend to be friends with other people the same age as them, and so forth. So I was interested in this phenomenon, and so I thought about ways that you could quantify this. So basically, if I'm looking at a network and I believe that, you know, there are groups here, maybe they're age groups, and I believe that most of the connections within age groups and few of them between age groups, then that's kind of like community structure. That's sort of what we mean by community structure. And most of the connections are within the groups. I kind of didn't make that connection to begin with. I was just interested in quantifying this assortative mixing thing. So I came up with some measure that quantifies it. And then later on, Michelle and I were interested in coming up with some measure for saying how good the community structures we were finding were, and just realized that this same measure that I had studied earlier in the context of quantifying assortative mixing was really the same thing. That you can imagine the groups are given to you, like I say, I give you the age groups or something like that, so there's some extrinsic thing, or you could imagine that there's something that you worked out for yourself by looking at the network, but it doesn't matter. Either way, you can ask, to what extent are these good groups? Most of the connections are within groups and few of them between groups. So yes, it turned out that the same measure could then be used, what we now call modularity, could then be used to quantify that as well. And you know, it was a two-step thing. Came up with a measure and it sort of didn't occur to me that it had this other use. And then in collaboration with Michelle, we put it to this other use later on, which is of course the use for which it's now best known.
And sort of that's one of the things that's interesting to me about now, going back and looking at some of this work, is how pregnant this work was with these links, even if they weren't there. Like, to me, so you have a nice claim at the moment. It's a Siam Reviews paper, which was the most cited paper in mathematics between 2001 and 2011. Yeah, or somewhere this sort of popped up as this claim. So that's a, you know, is a huge paper, and it was a monster paper in networks, but you go back and look at it now and it's woefully incomplete, but which just shows you how, you know, how fast the field has moved in the last 10, 13 years since it was published. But one of the things that stood out in that paper was this table that you had analyzed a whole series of networks, and showing that, you know, there was sort of great, the assortative mixing in human networks was really different than a lot of, say, technical networks. And this sort of seemed to suggest some property, even if it wasn't in the paper, if modularity wasn't quite there at the time. So I guess a question about that now, is this still holding this sort of, if we want to call it not a hard distinction between social networks and other networks, but this persistent notion that we tend to think of human networks as assorted, but a lot of other networks as disassorted.
I think it does hold out. So Bernie's referring to a particular kind of assortative mixing now. I was referring to it in generality as similar people like to be connected together. he's now referring to a specific example of that, namely a sort of mixing with respect to how many connections people have. So one property that you could mix according to is sort of how popular you are or how many friends you have. So people who are more popular tend to be friends with other people who are more popular. People who are less popular tend to be friends with other people who are less popular. You might think that could happen or it could not happen, but it's something you could go and check. So that's an interesting kind of assortative mixing. It's different from the other kinds I mentioned because the property that is determining the structure of the network is itself a property of the network. In this case, number of connections that people have, that's a network property, is determining who they connect with. That's also a network property. So this gives you an interaction between two separate properties of the network that gives rise to interesting structures. So this was one of the forms of assortative mixing that we studied, and a pattern that we noticed when you measure this in real networks is that indeed this does happen in social networks. The gregarious people are hanging out with the other gregarious people and the hermits are hanging out with other hermits. But it doesn't happen in most other kinds of networks. The internet, the World Wide Web, biological networks, technological networks. Actually, in most of those cases, the reverse happens. That actually the high degree nodes, the ones with many connections, are connected to the low degree nodes, the ones with few, and vice versa. I would say that this is a pattern that seems to hold out, and so presumably it's telling us this is something different about social networks that's not true of other kinds of networks. So one possibility is that this could be a psychological phenomenon, that the whatever it is about people that makes them want to have a lot of friends also makes them want to hang out with other people who have a lot of friends. I could believe that. You know, if I like knowing lots of people, then having friends who also know lots of people would be attractive to me. I can imagine that. Or if knowing lots of people is a result of a certain personality type, then hanging out with other people who have a similar personality type could be attractive to me. So I could certainly imagine that there was some psychological or sociological reason explaining this. Another possible explanation that we came up with was just that people tend to fall into groups or communities, and the groups or communities tend to vary in size. So if you're a member of a small group, then you know the other people in that group, and the other people know you. So that means you have a rather small circle of friends, and the other people in that group also have a small circle of friends because it's the same circle, right? So if I'm a close-knit group of six friends, we all know each other, then I have five friends and all of them have five friends. Whereas if I'm in a big group of like 100 people, then I have 99 friends and all of them have 99 friends. So just the fact that we break up into groups could give you this positive correlation between how many people know. People who are in big groups are in big groups with other people who are in big groups, the same big group, right? And people who are in small groups are in small groups with other people who are in small groups. So you automatically get a correlation there. And you can make a model of that. So the kind of thing we do is we say, oh, I think this might be an explanation. Let's go make a model of that thing and see if indeed it explains it. And it does. You can make a model of that and it gives you nice, strong, positive correlations of the kind that we see in the real world data. That doesn't say it's necessarily the right explanation. Just because my model shows some behavior and the real world shows some behavior doesn't mean that my model is a correct explanation of the real world. You know, I could say bears like honey, my wife likes honey, therefore my wife is a bear, and I'd be wrong. So it's not necessarily the explanation, but it's, you know, it's a possibility. Either of those two things could be the right answer. I don't know which it is.
Well, I mean, I don't know. It sounded almost like a categorical syllogism. We could have proved that one wrong 2,000 years ago.
Yep, yep.
But we've had to require computers to prove ourselves wrong on a number of other things more recently, I suppose. You know, getting back to assortativity, yeah, I made a bit of sort of a cognitive leap because now degree assortativity or being assorted by degree or number of friends seems to be the most common use of it. But that original assortativity was more categorical, wasn't it? And so this is like partitions, and you sort of compared it to this a previous variant of assortativity by Gupta et al., and which didn't weigh things in the same way and could give like crazy crazy results depending on whether the groups were of different sizes or not. But you know, you have this notion that there's like type, and then they organize themselves into groups. So now I, perhaps back to the bears syllogism there, I kind of want to ask your opinion of this now, and this is where we get into maybe philosophy of science, if you will. I know it's not your expertise, but you know, you've created a lot of methods that have now, either yours or derivations thereof, have now been shown, hey, we have communities, we have a community structure. We can color code this, we can look at this, you know, red's, you know, labor or Republican, and blue is Democrat or whatever. And then people show these pictures that have these partitions to them. And in some respects, when people see that picture, it becomes almost self-evident. Like, look, that is the community structure. Now, you have to walk that back in some respects, I'm sure, because that is a structure, not necessarily the structure. And then we have the work on, you know, overlapping communities and all sorts of other things. But now, how do you explain what a community is, knowing that it's not the same thing as what we have as like this offline community or a fuzzy community, but that it's this partition? And how can we take that explanation in such a way to kind of put a bit of padding around this community so that we don't just say, look, here's the community, but here is a result?
So it's certainly true that we cannot be sure when we split a network up into groups that we've got the right answer. Maybe there isn't one right answer. Sometimes you can compare your results with some known ground truth and find that it strongly correlates with divisions on lines of age or race or income or educational level or something like that, which suggests that you're onto something. However, it's certainly true that the methods we use don't give a definitive answer. They say, this is the best we can do, but we might be wrong here.
More than that, it's not just that they don't give a definitive answer, they almost create an answer. I mean, is it that there exists a Platonic latent space that we are projecting, or that we're projecting this onto, or are we, you know, constructing this by saying, look, it's good enough, but then we act on the communities and we say, we do partition you into this one, we do. And people put people in the other offices, oh, well, that looks like they're an office there, except for this one person who's not in the office but emails them all, so let's put him over there.
Well, I think, so there's a difference between the question of whether the communities have meaning and whether they simply exist on the mathematical level. I mean, if I find a good division of a network such that there are, you know, into two groups, such that there are very few connections into two groups, then it's true to simply say there are these very few connections between these two groups. I'm simply making a quantitative statement. So one, that may be useful in its own right, regardless of whether it's really correlated with anything mechanical about how the system behaves. It may be useful, for instance, just if I'm going to, you know, divide up the people into two sets of rooms and I don't want to put people far apart who are going to have to talk to each other or something like that, right? Just for purely practical purposes, I can imagine it would just be useful even if it doesn't have any sort of underlying meaning. It might also have some underlying meaning. I might be claiming that this is really correlated with some social dynamics or something that's going on, and then I have to be a little bit more careful. That's the point at which I have to say, well, you know, I can do my best to divide up this network, but I don't know, I can't guarantee that the thing I'll find really has meaning or is correlated with something of interest. That said, there are things we can do. So one thing that we do is we often these days, we don't just look for a division of the network into groups, we look for a probability distribution over divisions of the network. So we can say this is the most likely one, but we can say there are a bunch of other ones here that are also quite likely. And then what you can do is you can look at the ones that are likely and you can ask if they're all kind of similar. Because if they are, then that strongly suggests that the big picture is okay. Maybe you've got some nodes wrong around the edges. This node might be in this other group. It's a little fuzzy around the edges, but the big picture is okay. Whereas conversely, if there are many probable divisions of the network that are completely different, then your answer is entirely unreliable. So you have quantitative ways of saying whether your answers are reliable in much the same way as, you know, you can calculate a standard deviation when doing ordinary statistics. You have quantitative ways of saying how much the answer varies around the most likely solution. And one of the things that we find is that in practical cases that we're interested in, the community structure is often extremely strong in this sense. And a way this manifests itself in practice is that it turns out that pretty much any algorithm for finding community structure will get roughly the same answer in these networks. Any dumb algorithm will do the job. It doesn't have to be particularly fancy. Where the fancy algorithms come in is when they're detecting very weak signals, hard to detect structure in networks, and then a sophisticated algorithm can do better than something more primitive. But on the other hand, you could legitimately say that if the signal is very weak, if there's hardly any structure there in the network, then do we really care about it? In practice, the things we care about are the strong structure, which is likely to have an actual effect on the way the network behaves. So in many senses, we're sort of interested in the easy cases when we're solving this problem. We're interested in the ones where the structure's there and it's sort of banging over the head and you can't miss it. If it was really weak and difficult to see, then arguably you're not that interested in it anyway.
So one of the, and we I alluded to modularity earlier, and this is one of the ways in which you can provide a goodness of fit for distinct partitions in a graph. And then there's been all sorts of complicated variations on it, and extending the model and so forth. But when we teach it, because it's not it's not based on a frequentist style based on a t distribution. We have a p value. It's yada yada yada. We just get a number, and so then people say, well, what's a good number? And then they say, well, 0.6, oh, that's good. It's a good modularity. It's a modular graph. It's clearly very distinct groups. And 0.1 is like, I'm not really sure you've got much of a community structure there. It's become convention now. It's also lazy convention in the field to say if it's over 0.3, it's probably pretty modular. And I'm sure that that people are doing better than that. So what sort of like straightforward guidance can you offer beyond, beyond like LFR benchmarks or something, to say like, what can we do better than to just say, oh, it's 0.3, oh, you've got a good community. Below that, don't show it in color codes because those are probably not actually real partitions where the signal, as you mentioned, is too weak to be meaningful.
Yeah, so that's a good question. I think that this is one of the weak points of using the modularity, is that there isn't any sort of universal scale for what's good. Depending on what network you're looking at, a good number can be different things.
Yeah.
So it isn't sort of calibrated on a universal scale. In fact, I don't know of any measure that is calibrated on a universal scale. To give you an example, if you take a random network, so just take a bunch of nodes, throw down connections at random, what's called a random graph, then it's typically possible to find good divisions of that network that have actually quite high modularity, even though obviously there isn't any structure there because you just threw down the connections at random.
And you mean, right? Say, like a Bernoulli graph, you flip a coin, whether there's an
exactly
edge, and with a probability, 0.5, so it's a coin flip.
Yeah. Well, it would have to be sparse, so it would have to be a probability that's vanishing in the limit of large size. So not 0.5, but constant over n, where n is the number of nodes.
Okay, sure.
If you sort of just divide up the network at random, it's pretty obvious that, say, divide it into two groups of half the size, n over 2 nodes each, then on average, half of the edges are going to run between the groups and half of the edges are going to fall inside the groups because they're random. But, so that's not a good modularity. That's a terrible value of modularity. That's zero, actually. I think that's zero. Yeah, that's zero. So that's not a good value. But the thing is, there are an awful lot of ways of dividing up a network into two groups, right? Basically, if you're deciding which node to put each group in, you have one choice, yes or no, for each node. Well, two choices, I guess, yes or no. So you have 2^n possible ways of dividing it up, which is a huge number. You know, we've got 1,000 nodes, you've got 2^1,000, which is 10^300 or something, a 1 followed by 300 zeros. That's a huge number of divisions. And so it's true that most of them are not very good, but there's so many of them that if you look through them, you can always find one that's pretty good, right? So just because there are so many ways of dividing up the network, you can find one that's good even though it's just a random network. So
the
bottom line is then that you find like a nice high modularity, a modularity 0.5, and you say, oh, I found something, and you haven't at all. It was a completely random graph. It's just guaranteed that somewhere in a random graph there's a good division. So simply having a high value of modularity is not enough to guarantee that you have a good answer. In order to guarantee that you have a good answer, what you really need to do is what I said before, which is see whether competing solutions with high values of modularity are similar in some way. Because if you're in a random graph, then you'll find some division that has a good modularity. If you look for some more time through these 10^300 different divisions, you'll find another one that's also good. But because it's a random graph, the second one you find will be nothing like the first one. Yeah. It'll be totally different, right? So if you find 10 of these and you look at them all, you'll find they're all just completely different from each other, and that tells you that you haven't found anything. What you're looking for is you find sort of the 10 best solutions, and they're all almost the same thing. You know, one node maybe flips from this group to this other group, but they're basically all the same. Mm-hmm. That's telling you that you really have something here. So this is closely connected to a concept in physics called replica symmetry breaking, which is to do with this question of whether all the solutions are similar or all the solutions are different. And actually, the mathematics that we use to study how modularity behaves in random graphs is precisely this mathematics of replica symmetry breaking, which is borrowed from statistical physics and the study of spin glasses. And it precisely focuses on this question of Do the solutions all cluster together, all kind of similar, or are they all completely different? One case, you've discovered something, in the other case, there's nothing there.
Cool. I think we should be doing more of that in the social sciences, certainly. There's a back page. That makes sense. That's why it's... that's one of the things I wanted to ask about. Here's an odd sort of practical question. You've probably been given various weighty talks. But one of the things in this book that I found very novel had nothing to do with the formulae, and I wanted to ask you about it. It's to do with the fact that you describe the absolute mess of file formats and software in networks. First off, what compelled you to do that? Because, I mean, I think it's a great idea. It's like, when we try to explain to people, you have to use an ensemble of programs. Well, there's some stuff that's in iGraph, some it's in Network X, you might have to go to MATLAB for this, some of it's in Gephi, oh, you can use NodeXL for that. But that's rarely ever discussed as an actual form. Instead, people just say, you can do most of this in UCINET. And then whatever you can't do in UCINET just never makes it in the book. Or same for the book on PIAC, or et cetera, et cetera. So what compelled you to say, like, someone's got to say this, and do you think that's getting any worse, or do you think that's getting any better?
I think the software has certainly got better. There's probably also more of it, which means more to keep track of, but I think certainly the software has got better. There's a section in the book in which, before talking about how you write software to do calculations on networks, I point out that there's already a lot of software out there, and frankly, there's probably something that does what you need to do. And if there is, go use it, because it really isn't worth reinventing the wheel. And I think that this is an important point. One should not be embarrassed to use software that does what you want it to do. There's no need to write more stuff if it's already out there. However, there are a lot of times when you have to do your own calculations. Somebody's never done this before, and you have to write your own thing. Because of the proliferation of interest in this field in the last 20 years or so, there have been a lot of people who come along and write software packages. And, you know, it's not centralized. Everybody has opinions about these things, and so they write a bunch of different software packages, and now there are an awful lot of them. It's a very active field, so a lot of people who are doing this. There's also, you know, there's a division in the field between people who are on the methodology technical side, who are coming from computer science and maths and so forth, who are interested in developing software, and there are people who are coming from the application side who really are not interested in developing software. They want to study whatever the system they're studying. They do social networks or something like that, and developing software would be a big distraction from studying the actual social system they're interested in. So there's a big market for software to do these calculations because people aren't interested in developing it themselves. But in recent years, the result has been that, I mean, there are really some very good software out there. You mentioned Gephi, which I really like. You mentioned NetworkX, that I really like.
Yeah.
There are a bunch of good packages out there that have been written by very competent programmers and do the calculations right. And that's something we've seen more and more of in the last few years.
Are we seeing more and more of? I kind of feel like we hit the peak of that around the time that NetworkX and iGraph were coming out. Now it seems that there's still a lot locked up in MATLAB, or whatever the open source MATLAB is. I can't remember the
Octave.
I always got to give a shout out to that, if possible. Yeah, it does seem like there's still an awful lot locked up in there that the social scientists are not coming to. In a way that, say, I think from my perspective, community detection started really took off in a way partially because the early algorithms were very intelligible and very easy to communicate, and this may be easy to replicate in another language. And I feel we may be getting out of that, where now more advanced stuff is getting more advanced more quickly.
Uh-huh.
And no one's outside of maybe, I don't know, InfoMap or something like that, there's a threshold after which I've just never seen these things make it back into the packages.
Mm-hmm.
There's still no Jen Louvain in Python, for example. I don't know if I'll see your the generalized community structure stuff in Python or R, or if that will all be locked up in MATLAB. So is that the case, or am I just wanting something too early, or am I just going to have to wait for 5 years for someone to do it? How can I foster greater transfer, not just of papers on archive, but of algorithms to a usable state?
Uh-huh. So that's a good question. I think that there may be some truth in that, that the algorithms that have made it into the standard packages are the ones that are simpler to explain. That doesn't mean that they're necessarily trivial to program, and there are some very good implementations out there. But ones that are more complicated to do may not have made it into the packages. And, you know, it's even worse than that in some cases. At least with the stuff I do, some of the algorithms really require a lot of shepherding to get them to work. It's not just a black box where it's sort of plug and play. You know, it doesn't always converge, and you have to fiddle around with parameters a bit. And, you know, it takes some knowledge of how the maths works and so forth to finally get the program to work. And so turning these things into a black box which anybody can use, just pull down a menu and click on a button, is not a trivial exercise, because it would require some further development of the methods as well as just producing a good implementation. So some of the recent methods, some very sophisticated things based on spectral methods, based on inference methods, which can do very nice calculations on networks, but they're really sort of touchy algorithms. They're these fine-tuned machines. It's like having an expensive sports car or something, right? You wouldn't want to just drive it to work because it's going to break down after a while. But it's, you know, it gets very good results on the track. So I think that for that reason, we haven't seen some of these more sophisticated methods make it into the standard package.
No, but how is this a matter of social incentive structures, do you think? Or is it just they're done by graduate students and they when they're done, they're sick of it and they move on to the next thing?
I think that it's a product primarily of the way scientific research is set up, that it's divided between basic research and applications. And this is true in all fields. It's not just true in this one. But if you look in, you know, biomedical research, for example, there are people who do the basic science and they come up with some idea for a cure for something or something like that. Mm-hmm. But it's a long way away from being a product. And it's not just a question of taking their discovery and turning it into a pill or something like that. There's a whole lot of extra research that has to be done by clinical researchers and applied people before you can turn it into a product. And I think that that's sort of the stage that we're at with some of these methods, that the people who do basic mathematics and fundamental methods have done their bit and come up with something which sort of they can show that it basically works. Yes, you can get answers by doing this kind of thing, but they haven't yet turned it into a nice, highly tuned machine that can work.
Yeah. Two good metaphors. I think I like the biomedical one maybe more than the sports car, but maybe that's just it. I'm just looking for something. I'm impatient. Uh-huh. I mean, my one concern, if in articulating it this way, though, is that then we say, oh, well, then just we need more applied research, and in fact, we don't. We need, in my estimation, we'd need more pathways between, you know, basic research and more applied research.
Well, it depends what you call applied. By applied here, I'm thinking, can we get some computer scientists involved with this? So, you know, I develop algorithms, but I'm not a computer scientist, right? I don't really know how to program, right? I'm a seat of the pants programmer.
Sure.
You know, learned when they were a teenager. You know, I can write code that works and gets the answer, but I can't write beautiful programs with pull-down menus and nice graphics and stuff like that. So, you know, there are people out there who are good at that stuff, and maybe we need to get them involved. So it depends what you call applied, but turning one of these ideas for an algorithm into a finished product requires a kind of expertise that I, for example, don't have. You can call it what you like, but there's definitely something else that needs to fill in the gap there. And I think the difference with some of the early algorithms that people worked on that you mentioned were rather simple to explain is that you really didn't need this. Yeah. That there really wasn't a gap between describing it in the basic research literature and then just putting it in a software package, because it was sufficiently simple that, you know, it really was one size fits all, just write these 10 lines of code and run them and it'll go. And we've got now to the stage where the field is sufficiently advanced that there are some really quite complicated things out there where there are now several levels that you have to go through before you can produce a working thing.
I told you we'd get to stuff in the future.
Uh-huh.
And that's part of it. What's your take on, and speaking of that, and or the future of these studies, what's your take now on, I guess, the search for taming overlapping communities? And I don't want to say for overlapping. We have methods for overlapping communities, whether it's Oslam or InfoMap or Jen Louvain. These are all techniques for showing these things. Urey's conductance-based measure, right? I can't remember what it's called now. It seems like when we shift from the hard partitioning problem of you're in this group or you're in this group, to there's a probability to which you can be assigned to one group or a probability to another group, not only does the math get more fuzzy, but the concept gets more fuzzy. Are we closer to taming the concept?
So I think the broader question here is about other kinds of structure that can occur in networks. I don't want to, you know, spend all our time just talking about community structure. That's rather a specific area. But there are other kinds of structure, of course, in networks. So overlapping community structures is one, which is really only a small step away from looking at community structures. But there are many other things as well. Yes, core periphery structures, hierarchical structures, ranking, latent space structures, other kinds of things that definitely occur in networks. We'd like to be able to understand how to quantify these, specify exactly what we mean, and then discover them in networks that we're looking at. And I think that this is definitely a growth area for the future. There's been this huge amount of work on community structure, and really, you know, it's just this one thing. It's like, all right, get over yourselves, do something else for a while. I know I can say that. I've been working on this problem for 10 years. But really, you know, there are other things out there. For instance, I did some work a couple of years ago with one of my students on social networks of school children from this study, the Ad Health study. It's a big U.S. study of friendship patterns in schools. So people have looked at community structure in those networks, and there's interesting community structure there. For instance, schools are divided by grade, you know, which year the students are in, and they're divided into racial groups and various other things. So there's interesting community structure going there. But we were looking at another thing, this sort of social hierarchy in the school. In particular, friendship data is an interesting one because what you get in the data set is a directed network. Which is a little bit odd. You think about friendship as being a two-way street, right? It should be an undirected thing. Either we say these two people are friends or they're not. But it's not what you actually get out of the data. It's actually Anatol Rapoport, after whom the chair I hold is named, was one of the first people to study this in the Ann Arbor School District. He did a bunch of studies of social networks in children in the town of Ann Arbor, where the University of Michigan is. And so what he did and what people do to this day is they just say, you know, who are you friends with? List your friends. Here's a questionnaire. List who you're friends with. And so the fundamental unit of response you get is that person A says that they're friends with person B. So that's a directed link. I say I'm friends with you. You find a surprising fraction of the time that then person B doesn't say they're friends with person A. Right? It goes one way but not the other way. About 50% of the time in typical studies, something like the fraction that it only goes one way. So you're like, well, what's going on here? There must be something wrong with this. Our data are flawed. Clearly we're missing something. Are these people friends or they're not friends? What does it mean if only one person says they're friends and the other person doesn't? So that's been the attitude a lot amongst people studying these data, that there's basically something wrong with the data. There's something missing that you're not seeing. And maybe that's part of it. But there's another possibility, which is that these one-way connections are actually telling you something about the social structure of the school. And this was the hypothesis that we started off with in this study, is that people tend to say they're friends with people who are cooler than them, basically. If you ask them who they're friends with, they'll say, oh, I'm friends with that kid over there because he's really cool, right? But if you ask the cool kid whether he's friends with, he won't admit it, right? He'll say. So it only goes one way, and so maybe this is why you see these one-way things, right? When you see two-way things, and you do 50% of the time, then that's two people who are really friends with each other. When you see it's one way, it's like somebody who wants to be friends with the cool kid, but it's actually, you know, questionable. So if this were really true, then in principle you could deduce the hierarchy, the social hierarchy of the school, by looking at which way the edges go. So that was the purpose of this. So there's another kind of structure, right? This is not community structure. It's this sort of social ranking where everybody gets ranked from low to high. And if you look at the one-way edges, then allegedly, at least, they should point from lower-ranked person to a higher-ranked person. So then the trick is, let's find some ordering of the kids in the school such that all of the edges point upwards. Well, it's not actually possible to do that, but you'd be surprised. You can get, on average, about 98% of them to point upwards.
No way.
And only 2% of them point down. So it's a really strong effect. It's definitely there. It's not just that these arrows are pointing in random directions, that just half of your data is missing at random. Absolutely not. you can get almost all of them point upwards. So it's a very strong effect. And we find that it correlates with other sort of widely accepted measures of social status, like age, for instance. In schools, it's widely accepted by sociologists that the older kids have higher social status than the younger kids. Anybody who's actually been to school knows this. And indeed, the status measures that you get from looking at the direction of the edges correlate strongly with age, for instance. So there's just one example of another kind of structure, which might in principle be present in a lot of other networks. So I think that a large part of the game here is not just to concentrate on one kind of structure, but to think about what other kinds of structure might be present and go looking for them, because if you don't, then you're never going to know that they're there. There's a sort of exploratory element to this, which is that the things that everybody discusses when they're looking at social networks and other kinds of networks are the things that everybody discusses, right? It's sort of this self-fulfilling prophecy that if these are the things that are popular, then that's what everybody's going to look at. And we want to get away from that a bit. We want to think of other interesting things that might be going on here that nobody's thought to look at yet.
So, well, first of all, wow, thanks for that answer, because I was actually going to come around to that one later in sort of comparison of these sort of like fuzzy self-reported networks versus like hard cell phone data and that sort of thing, and mm-hmm. whether the first one is, you know, is the fuzziness of self-reported work a bug or a feature? For a while, we've thought of it as a bug, and then the more people look at it, the more they think it's not necessarily a bug. It actually shows some sort of latent factor in there, such as me remembering trends but not yesterday, or me remembering hierarchy, and so forth. So we're done with that. You know, clearly you have a bit of an appreciation for sometimes this messiness in the data is not a problem per se. It's a feature, it's a challenge. Uh-huh. But while you were talking, I kind of wanted to get a definition of something, and maybe other people in the room could inform me of that definition. I'd love to hear yours. What structure?
Uh-huh. Well, good question. So there are lots of possible answers to that. Maybe structure is what makes a network differ from random.
Yeah, I was going to say, should we use an information theoretical definition?
Yeah, exactly. So the information theoretical idea would be it's what makes it different from random. So if we're talking about structure in just a string of numbers, then it's what makes it different from random. How much does the Shannon entropy differ from the maximum entropy if it were truly random?
But you know, in this case, though, I mean, sort of the complex systems and dependency structures, I mean, we have a notion of stochastic, but, I mean, the notion of random itself is pretty hard. That's where degree distribution came from, or using degree distribution or configuration model.
Yeah, so this is not something that we have a good handle on at the moment. So we know of plenty of examples of non-randomness in networks. So actually, it gets back to this thing we were just talking about a moment ago, that you need to go looking for other kinds of structure than the ones that people are already looking for, because you'll never find them if you don't look for them. Yeah. And this is a similar sort of issue, that you can demonstrate structure by demonstrating that there is a particular kind of non-randomness in your data, such as, say, community structure or a non-trivial degree distribution. But you have to think of what you're going to look for, right? So we're at this sort of stage in this field where what we have is this sort of grab bag of tools, of things that people look at in networks that's basically just arisen historically. It's a historical artifact of what people happen to be interested in, and also maybe of what's particularly relevant for the networks that we are looking for. Like, community structure may well be a very relevant thing in real social networks. Right, exactly. Power laws. So there are, what we have is this sort of selection of tools that people use that's sort of often immortalized in the pull-down menus of our network analysis software, that, you know, here's the 30 different things that you can measure using this piece of software. And I don't think there's any sense in which these are the only things we can look at, or even the most important things to look at. They're things which have proved useful historically, but who's to say that there aren't some other things that we haven't thought to look at that turn out to be really interesting? So I think we don't have sort of any general theory which says which are the right things to look at. Absolutely, we're currently at a stage where it's rather hard to define what structure is other than relative to the things that we normally look at. Structure can be a power law degree distribution. It can be a high value of the modularity. But it could be some other thing that nobody's thought of yet.
Any hunches?
Of other things that we could look at?
Yeah. So this generalized, generalizing community structure, or I feel like there's a sense there that you were exploring something that's not merely hard partitions that are based on, you know, mm-hmm. edge density,
mm-hmm.
but yeah.
Yeah. So Bernie's referring to some stuff that we did recently on latent space structure in networks, where you imagine that the nodes of a network are embedded in some space and that the probability of connection between edges depends on where you are in the space. For instance, in the simplest case, two nodes that are close together in the space could be more likely to be connected. The space could be an actual space, like a geographic space. People are more likely to be friends if they live on the same street or something. But it could also be some more notional idea of space, like age, for instance. Two people who are close together in age more likely to be friends than two people who are far apart in age. That's one example of a kind of structure, although that wasn't novel with our work. People have thought about latent space structures before. What we did was come up with a way of inferring it. But the idea is older than that. That's one example of another kind of structure that you could look at, but there are probably other ones out there, and it's sort of hard to know exactly which ones are most important. I don't think that we have an answer about what the real structure of real networks is. You know, what is the best way to describe the structure of this network? We don't have that. What we have is that this network has community structure in it, or this network has interesting correlations in it. There's no claim that this is sort of the definitive way to describe it. Maybe there's something else there that we haven't seen.
So, on that note, it makes me wonder about this term that's emerged, network science, which I threw it around there today. I didn't know what to say. I didn't want to say physics, but is this merely a historical blip in statistical physics or statistical analysis of any sort where we all of a sudden plucked off a whole bunch of low-hanging fruit on this particular configuration of elements and tuples of elements. And then we just, because we cleaned up so fast, because we have lots of new data from the internet, and then we're just gonna go back into our own disciplines after another 10 years where we start, you know, it gets really high-dimensional latent space and type analysis that really gets far away from this. Or do you think networks qua networks has legs moving forward?
Well, so there's really two different questions there. One about the future of this field and one about whether it's sort of interdisciplinary and will go on being collaborations between different areas. So I think to tackle the second question first, that science is becoming more interdisciplinary all the time, something that I strongly support. And I think that people...
That's new at the OAI.
I'm glad to hear it.
We all are.
And I think that many people are realizing this. I think that Oxford has certainly been a champion of this. My own institution, the University of Michigan, is very enthusiastic about this. And I think that there are a lot of younger scientists coming up now who are very enthusiastic about it. And they're the ones who are going to steer the future directions of science. So I think it's something that's going to happen. And I think that that's a good thing. I think that there's a lot of stuff that can be done by combining ideas from different fields. The kind of interdisciplinary research that I do is not necessarily research that actually spans two disciplines. It may be firmly rooted in the study of, say, social networks, mm-hmm. but it can apply ideas from another field to studying that, say, physics or computer science. There's also interdisciplinary research which actually actively straddles two different fields and combines things from both of them, though that's not so much what I'm doing. But all of these are good things to do. Absolutely, combining things from different areas gives you much richer answers to problems than taking a strictly disciplinary look at the field. On the issue of the future of networks itself, I think that there's certainly lots more to do in this field. My friend and collaborator Stephen Strogatz has asked me in the past whether he thinks this field is sort of, you know, peaked and we've really found all the interesting results and maybe we're on the way down. I don't think he actually believes that, but he's, you know, he's being devil's advocate, asking whether really it's, we've seen everything we're going to see. And I think the answer is no. The analogy I like to give is that I think that the study of networks at this stage is a similar level to the study of quantum mechanics in physics before the discovery of the Schrodinger equation. Schrodinger equation being the fundamental equation of quantum mechanics without which you basically can't do anything. Right? So before they discovered that, they had some sort of ideas. They had a few things that they could measure that looked interesting. And they had some ideas about what was going on, but they didn't have the actual theory. And I think that that's the stage we're at with networks. I think that we've discovered a bunch of interesting things that look promising, and there's really something here, and I think this is an interesting field, but we don't have really an overarching body of theory that describes these things. As I say, it's currently kind of grab bag of tools. This works, and this works, and this works, but no real reason to think that these are the right things or no theory that joins them all up. So I think that we're really at a very early stage in this field and that there's probably some big discoveries to be made out there.
Exciting. So, I mean, that's it's a great note for me to end my portion of this on. Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much for that, for those answers. It's really handy. And, you know, it's not just such a retread of other stuff. You've really left a trail of breadcrumbs for a lot of people to consider following up on in future work. I figured I'd give it out to the floor, see if you guys want to join the conversation for a little bit, and then after that, whenever we get a natural break to a maximum of 5:30, then I'll just arbitrarily make a break. Then there's some wine out there if you guys want to have a drink before your evening plans. But questions, free for all. You already talked out. You guys have all had a chance to chat with him.
I just want to follow your question. So what is the Schrodinger equation in networks? What is the big exciting
move? Well, if I knew that, then yeah. I would be doing it. Right. No, absolutely. What I'm saying is that we haven't yet discovered that. I'm saying we're at the stage that they were before that they discovered that. And I don't know for certain that it exists, but yeah. At some point, I'm hoping, we will develop a more unified theory that lets us understand this in some big picture way.
Will we have to wait for quantum mechanics for that? I mean, I'm being deadly serious here. I mean, there's a lot of stuff in networks when we get down to it. We're trying to find estimations for things that are, you know, NP hard or NP complete. And they're trying to dance around that in a way within quantum mechanics and in statistical quantum computing. So, for example, I mean, one thing that the social network people have been really prideful of is exponential random graph models, which are really only tractable on incredibly tiny networks because they just require so many realizations. And I don't think that we're going to get much. We're just going to come up with a new estimator for these things, but we're not really going to have a breakthrough until we have a breakthrough in computation.
Yeah, so I think part of the limitation is just sheer computer power, but what I'm thinking of really is more understanding that there's just some fundamental concepts that we're missing yet, and once we find them, that things will make more sense. And at the moment, I don't think we've got that.
Thoughts from the audience? Yeah.
Thank you so much for the comments, Scott Helmer, research scientist here. And, I have a question just maybe about what doesn't fit into a network. What what isn't didactic in a relationship? I mean, networks are great, and I do a lot of networks, but we always hit these corner cases as well, and you try to take real world empirical data, and then you're putting into a network. You take an email, emails between individuals, and most emails are, you know, didactic between two people, but then you hit a mailing list and you go, oh, we're just going to discard those, or we'll do something with this group of people. Okay, we'll just split that up. And so, I don't know, what is missing in networks, or is there anything that we what can't we model with a network, and what are alternatives or extensions that help us?
What shouldn't we?
Yeah, what should we?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, that's the question.
Yeah, I think it's a good question. I'm definitely not so much a network partisan, and I think everybody should be studying networks and everything should be looked at as a network. Absolutely, it's not. So I think your point about mailing lists is well taken, that there are some things where we need some sort of extension of what's a network. We need to add some extra entities into it, not just dyadic connections between actors. And the reason that people haven't done that very much is that the problem's already hard enough as it is, right? We're trying to do the easy things first, but that doesn't mean that there aren't practical cases where something more complicated is needed. However, there are, on the other side of that, there are also things which shouldn't be regarded as a network at all in the first place. And this is something that I sometimes complain about in work that I see being published, is that people got the idea that networks are this fun, trendy thing that everybody's really interested in at the moment, so let's turn our problem into a network. And I don't really agree with that approach. If it's not fundamentally a network to begin with, then don't make it into one. Networks are a very specific thing. That is, it's an object that is designed to represent sparse data. In other words, cases where most possible connections are not present. So if I think about who I'm friends with, you know, I maybe have 100 friends or a few hundred friends at most, and there's 7 billion people in the world. So almost everyone that I could potentially be friends with, I am not friends with. Almost every possible connection between people in the world is a non-connection. It's not there. So the data is very, very sparse. That's the case that is dealt with by what we call network science. There are many other cases which simply don't fall into that category. And in particular, if you have dense data where, you know, everything is interacting with everything else, then you shouldn't be looking at it as a network. It doesn't stop people from doing that, but I think they're making a mistake. There are other techniques that we have for dense data that work perfectly well, and you shouldn't be just trying to shoehorn it into a network paradigm because networks are popular right now. So both sides of the equation are true. There are things which should not be looked at as networks, other methods appropriate, and there are things which could be looked at networks, but it's probably not adequate. You need to add something more to the picture in order to understand them. In the first case, I think we already have a pretty good handle on what to do. Dense data is well taken care of and has been since the 19th century. In the case where there are other things, like the mailing list example you gave, I think that that's tricky. I think that that's something we probably will get to, but we haven't yet. And the main reason is just because we do the simple things first. Other question?
I've just got one. Well, kind of a wishy-washy question, but
please.
You mentioned the latent space approach, which I don't know much about, but it sounds a bit more like sort of standard data approach where you have some complex data and you want to project it down to some kind of simpler lower dimensional space to understand it. Is that what you're sort of getting at with this search for structure? Is it almost sort of removing this freaky weird network data and making it look like normal data because
Yeah, in some cases it's doing that. So the difficult thing about network data is this sort of discrete nature, that there's connections between people, there's not connections. It's a yes-no thing. There can be stronger and weaker connections, but still they're either there or they're not there, right? And it turns out that mathematically speaking, this is a very difficult thing to deal with. Sparse, discrete data really breaks a lot of the sort of standard 19th century mathematics that's traditionally been used to study large data sets like this. I'm particularly thinking of linear algebra methods like singular value decomposition, eigenvector decomposition, and stuff like that. They are badly broken in the case of sparse discrete data. So yes, exactly, one of the things that we do is we try and turn it back into something that looks like what we know how to handle, meaning sort of continuous, real-valued, low-dimensional data. That's not the only approach that we take. There are other methods, sparse matrix methods and inference methods and stuff like that, which work out well, things like message passing, belief propagation, which work well on sparse data that have been developed relatively recently. But it's a fundamentally different kind of data. It is tricky to handle, and traditional methods don't work well. So yeah, either turn it into something we recognize or have to come up with something new altogether.
Maybe a quick follow-up question on what Bernie said about networks being a really popular field these days, and that network science is now evolving at a really rapid pace. On the one hand, we've seen a lot of statisticians and mathematicians have been really blasting to the field, advancing the methods. But when it comes to the application side, I feel like we've hit a point where it's almost like a problem that these academic communities don't really talk to each other. So we have geographers, we have social scientists, and you have all these different other fields that come up with, that use the methods that have been developed by the mathematicians and statisticians, and then publish in their own discipline-specific conferences and journals that don't really find a wide enough audience for this to be useful for the whole field. So where do you see the evolution of this multidisciplinary approach of network science, if you want to call it that way?
Yeah. So this has always been a problem with interdisciplinary research, that people talk different languages and therefore they tend not to read each other's papers, and it makes collaboration more difficult. And it's certainly true in this field that people don't understand each other's languages. I think the solution is for people to make more effort. it's a hard thing to do. It requires work, but let me point out that you can make a very good living doing this. I think that arguably most of what I've done in my work is to combine ideas from other fields. You know, take an idea from sociology and take an idea from maths and sort of apply one to the other, something like that. So for instance, the idea of assortative mixing, which is called homophily in the social science literature, is an old one that's been around for a long time, but what I was doing was, you know, I knew about that literature, I talked to sociologists, and I thought that sounds like something that you could do some maths with. You could come up with something quantitative here. And so really, that was just combining ideas that were already out there. So yes, it's work to learn the language of more than one different area, but there's a lot of rewards. That by combining things, you can come up with a lot of stuff that's not there in either subject on its own.
Maybe just a quick follow-up. And what do you think is the implication for young researchers who are now facing the choice whether they should join, say, a sociology department after their graduation, or maybe a statistics department, or maybe a math department, or any department, knowing that no matter what they choose, there will be at the periphery of that. Each department, if they dedicate to their lives to, you know, these methodologies.
Yeah. I think that because of the way the world works, it's a wise idea to pick one area that you sort of feel you belong to, because it's a cultural question as well as a technical one, mm-hmm. right? It's not just about what methods you use, it's also about where you fit in. And like it or not, if you want to get a job, you have to fit in somewhere. I consider myself to be a physicist. I have a physics background, I teach physics, I think like a physicist, but I'm very interested in sociology, computer science, applied mathematics. I think that it's a good idea, just from a career point of view, to sort of decide what your identity is and where you fit in with the academic world. But at the same time, if you, if it appeals to you, to learn about more than one different field and maybe try and bring ideas from other people's fields into your area, or apply ideas from your area to some other problem that's outside that traditional area. You're right, it does mean that you're always going to be one foot in your field and one foot in someone else's, or three different feet in three different other fields. And you know, how comfortable you are with that will vary from person to person. I actually really enjoy it. I enjoy being a physicist but still being involved with several other communities. I certainly accept that that's not for everyone, but I wouldn't say it's necessarily a bad thing. Mm-hmm. I think that it can be a lot of fun.
Oh, I'm dying to ask a follow-up because I want a bit of teeth here. I want some teeth. That the sociologists have whinged about these, or whined if you're North American, whinged about, oh, physicists coming in, colonizing the field, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not sure if you guys have encountered that. It's the same way that Canadians worry about Americans, but Americans don't seem to worry about Canadians very much at all, I think, in that one. But as a Canadian who was working elsewhere in the world, it was important for me to learn other cultures, as distinct as Canada and the UK are, which is not really. Where am I going with this, you may ask? Is not, you know, what can physicists do for sociologists? I get it, they complain, not every paper that got written got cited. It's kind of an old critique and I'm really tired of it. What can sociologists do to better collaborate with physicists? I mean, you've come across a few, like at Santa Fe, Doug White comes through from time to time. I know you've chatted a bit with Jim Moody, and Duncan Watts is kind of on the periphery of sociology, but if he said he was a sociologist, I wouldn't challenge him on it. But what can we do to make ourselves, from your perspective, more accommodating to work from physicists or statistical mechanics? Learn code? Learn MATLAB?
No, absolutely not. I think that people in different areas have different things to contribute, mm-hmm. and people in all the areas involved with studying networks have contributed interesting ideas, and one should play to one's strengths.
Yes.
So, for instance, I have a great collaboration at the moment with a very talented sociologist at the University of Michigan called Elizabeth Brook, who is primarily a demographer and extremely knowledgeable about the kind of sociology which she does, which sort of perhaps straddles the areas of sociology and geography, and we're working on some projects to do with online networks at the moment, and our areas of expertise are essentially non-overlapping. You know, my contributions are on the technical side, that I know the algorithms and the measures and so forth, and I'm developing the code and I'm doing calculations, and her contribution is that she actually knows the community that we're looking at and the system that we're looking at and how the sociology works. And so that's exactly how these things should be. Yeah. Now, not every sociologist is interested in collaborating with a physicist like that, which is fine. That's okay, you don't have to be.
But how do I present? Okay, so I'm gonna. I love that. I think the idea. Yes, be a good sociologist. Number one. But if I'm a good sociologist, how do I knock on your door and say, "Hey, Mark, I've got this interesting problem, and I don't know how to solve it." I mean, in the UK, we're gonna come up with this, and this is gonna be a significant challenge for, say, the Alan Turing Institute, of which the OII is a part. This is partially for our own interest, because if the ones from us that go there will then be speaking with a lot of computer scientists and physicists. And how do we present that to you guys? What's an attractive way to say, I have this problem?
I don't know. If it's an interesting problem, then it probably solves itself. I mean, so Elizabeth had the data for this study that we're doing, and she just came, she did exactly that. She knocked on the door one day and basically said, I have this really interesting data set, and let me tell you about it. And by the end of the conversation, she had me convinced. It was really interesting. Other people have said, I have this really interesting data set, and they're like, yeah, Yeah, sure, that's interesting. Why don't you go study that? So you know, so it varies.
All right.
But absolutely, I mean, if it's a really interesting problem, you can sell it, then I'm sure people will be happy to work on it. I think that in this field, for sure, people who do kind of stuff I do, which is basic methodology, ways of analyzing data, are certainly interested in hearing about new data sets that these methods could be applied to. I actually do relatively little of this kind of applied stuff, where I'm actually looking in detail at one particular data set, rather than the methodology thing, which is sort of thinking about, in general, how you would go about analyzing data sets. But if, you know, a nice opportunity like this presents itself, then it's fun to, you know, get your feet wet.
Great.
Final questions, thoughts? Don't drag this on. All right, so, you know, with that, I think maybe I'll just call to a close. I think hopefully this will have stimulated you guys so that, you know, get some interdisciplinary collaboration going on in that way. Also, he had not asked me to plug this, but we have used it in the past in courses, and you can see it's annotated. Well, you can't see it, but it is annotated. So it's a book for those. And Mark?
Also makes a great paperweight.
Also makes a great, it does. I can tell you that, but if you want to read, there's definitely words in it. And formulae too. No, thank you very much, Mark.
All right, very good.
Generous.
Thank you.
And thank you.